All right. Good morning, everyone. It's one of those mornings, no? I had a fear that this was going to happen. You know, nice place, good drinks, bad coffee, and the rest is history, right? So that's why I took precautions. We're going to start the morning with a little game. All you need to play this game is a pen and a pencil and a piece of paper. If you don't have that, just your mind, all right? I'm going to show you a picture. It's going to be up on the screen for 5 seconds. I'd like you to take a look at this picture and take a mental note, or literally a written note, of what you see. You guys ready? Yeah? That much at least has entered the brain, no? That instruction? Fantastic. Here we go. At least we should be going. This one's not working. There we go. All right. Ready? Let's go. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Write down what you see. Don't tell anyone or think of it. Who wants to have a go? Who saw something?
An Aztec god.
An Aztec god. Fantastic. Anybody else see something else? These lights are a bit blinding. Yeah, Jane. A Volkswagen Beetle. Jeez. What's in your coffee? Anybody else see something different? Back there, yeah. A who? A frog. An owl. All right. Nice. Yeah, last one. What do you see, sir? Sorry? A maze. A maze. Now, a labyrinth. Now, this isn't a trick, and you're not seeing one image, and this guy is seeing another one over here, right? You all saw the same image. And, of course, you know, you guys are learning professionals, and so this little trick is going to be somewhat obvious to you. But, you know, how do we actually see the same image yet different things? Why? Obvious things. You know, someone sees an owl and another person, Jane, a Volkswagen. Anybody? Yeah. Right, previous experiences. What else?
Filters.
What are filters, though? Perception, but perception is based on?
Your education.
Education, right? Dare I say sex sometimes, you know, this man-women thing. Preferences, right? And maybe what you had for breakfast, I don't know. But, right, all these things essentially shape the frame through which we see the world, right? And so when you look at an image or when you look at a situation, your frame is different than mine. We might see different things. By the way, the Beetle, right? Can you see the Volkswagen Beetle?
Yeah.
Hear the headlights? The tires? This is the hood? And the guy's in California. He's got a surfboard on top, right? So well spotted, Jane. What if I were to tell you, don't see the Beetle anymore? It's tough, right? So these frames are incredibly powerful. Here's another one, just to see if you're awake. What do you see? And if you say tree, I'm going to flunk you immediately. Right? It's not just any old tree. It's a particular tree, right? It's what Hyperion, Northern California. Right? But to see the tree, you have to remove the frame. And so we often talk about these people that are actually lacking a frame as innovators, right? They're people that come into a situation. They don't have the frame, the common frame of those in that context, and they're able to acquire a systemic view, connect dots, and essentially transform what's happening there. So we're going to talk this morning a lot about frames. You know, if you came thinking that I'm going to deliver some amazing insight, you know, you could leave now because that's not going to happen. The only thing academics are good for, if they're good for anything at all, is actually trying to make sense of the world with some frames. You know? And so I'm going to share with you what frames we're using at IESE to make sense of the world around us. And the world around us is, of course, changing, right? Many factors are determining its change. Neuroscience and the amazing discoveries about the brain, confirming and disconfirming beliefs. You know, no more learning styles, and yet, for example. No, not only, you know, the modern learner. This is a chart from Burson. You know, this impatient, sort of distracted, overwhelmed individual that can't fit, you know, a minute of learning into their daily life, let alone, you know, the programs that we've designed up until now. Skills, the nature of skills, they're the shelf life of skills, right? As business transforms, business need new people with new skills and capabilities. You know, emotional intelligence, pops up on the chart and was absent only a few years ago, right? But we're going to talk about one particular influencer of change, and that is digitalization. The other ones are important, making the situation even more complex. We're going to focus, though, on digitalization, you know? Maybe your kids, but definitely your employees. And what is digitalization doing in terms of learning and specifically executive development? We're going to look at three things. It's going to be a little bit quick and sort of kind of drinking from a fire hydrant, which is not the type of learning you want to do, but I thought, you know, why not try it on with you who are experienced professionals and you know, maybe some of these ideas might resonate. So we're going to talk first about why digitalization is changing learning, executive development, and refer to a concept called digital density. We're going to then actually ask ourselves, what does learning look like in the digital age for executives? And finally, you know, if that's what it looks like, how can we actually become enablers of that? Three parts, roughly half hour. All right, so let's get started. First of all, to understand why digitalization is important, we need to understand exactly what it is. How many of you remember this sort of headline from the New York Times, right, Nick? The year of the MOOC, 2012. I mean, it seems like yesterday. It's actually like 5 years ago, right? And what was the number one question that we asked ourselves when we saw that headline? You went up to a colleague, you looked at him in the face and said, well, what's a MOOC? And? Do universities become obsolete? Right, do we have a MOOC strategy? That's what people did at IESE. Do we have a MOOC strategy? And I'm sure at your companies as well, maybe still asking that question, right? And it was the same question the marketing guys asked themselves when they saw social. They said, hey, do we have a social strategy? And they put up Facebook pages. Or the sales guys said, hey, do we have a mobile strategy? And they created an app, right? And so we asked ourselves, do we have a MOOC strategy? I think 5 years removed, perhaps we can rephrase that question into a different one. And perhaps MOOCs are just the tip of the iceberg, if you will, of a much broader phenomenon. What is that phenomenon? We've come to talk about it as digitalization. And it's important to think about, you know, digitalization as an enabler or as a source of opportunity before talking about the technologies themselves. No, and what are those opportunities? So the first one, you know, we think is relevant is connections, right? What is actually digital enabling? What is it allowing us to do? It's allowing us to connect. And for, you know, years ago, connections had to do with companies, the intranet, which we all love, right? The intranet probably hasn't changed at all, by the way. But, you know, definitely the connections today are different. Today, you know, we're connecting our homes, right? Some of us are connecting, or many of us are connecting via mobile devices to people. And finally, you know, if you talk to Cisco and the likes, you know, we will start increasingly connecting things. In fact, the internet of everything. So, you know, this amazing ability to connect people to people, people to things, etc. That's one phenomenon. If you connect people and things and so on, the second thing that you can enable, the second opportunity has to do with interactions, right? So as these connections start to flourish, the interactions that they allow are richer and fundamentally, in fact, different. You know, we used to have to go somewhere to do something in terms of taking advantage of these interactions. Remember, you know, these days we still do this, or some of us still do this at least, all right? You go to a bank machine and take out money. But today, you know, these interactions are, and these connections, and therefore the interactions are ubiquitous. And they're allowing us to do things in contexts that were, that can be either online or offline that are actually sort of everywhere, right? So you can you can book a taxi, sit in the back seat, listen to your music that is sitting on your server at home, and pay with your PayPal account, right? It's a blurred line in terms of the offline and online world. And the third aspect of digitalization has to do with information. So, you know, the connections are important, interactions that travel on those connections are important. All of that is generating data, right? This famous data issue. And obviously the question that we have to ask ourselves, that we are asking ourselves, is what do you do with this data, right? It's not only a window on the past, but what do you do with it in terms of informing the future? So when we think about digitalization and what opportunities it allows ourselves. Perhaps we have to remove our, you know, the focus from the technologies and actually shift it to what we refer to as digital density, meaning this fabric that is essentially permeating our lives. And as a result of this permeation of our lives, allowing us to do the same things in fundamentally different ways. you know, digital density today might be 10. You know, if we think of this room, how many of us are connected digitally? How many of our interactions are happening digitally? How much information are we generating and actually using? But it might come a time when that digital density approximates 100. And therefore, what will that world look like? So that's kind of the bedrock. I want to think, though, about these frames and the frames that we need to break and the new ones that we need to acquire. And to do that, the first example I want to share with you has to do with a school called Minerva. Who knows Minerva? Anyway, yeah, quite a few. Who wants to describe Minerva in a nutshell? One phrase, two, or three? Anyone? What is Minerva? To different parts of the world. So this entrepreneur, Ben Nelson, graduate of the Wharton School, set up the first, actually, Ivy League, what he believes will become an Ivy League institution in the last century or more of U.S. history, right? His ambition is actually to create a school as good as Harvard for a fraction of the cost, right? And as you say, you know, it's a kind of unique experience, right? Let's look a little, just a minute, at what that experience entails. So the person he hired to actually design that experience is a man by the name of Stephen Kosen. You know, Stephen Kosen, not a bad career, right? The guy, dean of Stanford, professor at Harvard. You know, most academics I know at IESE would say, hey, yeah, not too shabby, right? And he jumps ship to basically start, to join a startup, to join Ben on this crazy mission of creating an Ivy League institution for half or a quarter of the cost. Right? Why does he do it? And the answer is here. I wanted to help build something better. Let's look at what he built and then comment on it as we watch the video. So this is what Stephen refers to as interactive seminars. Right? Class starts. Students log on. Here they are. And there's the professor that joins them. There's some funky technology, gesture control and so on. Interactive discussions. The student poses a question. Drops down to the front. Holding. The professor asks students to vote. There are the votes and who said what. Simulations. Students participate in real time. Debates. This is a bit American. Two students debating, the others voting down here. You know, they like that stuff. Collaborative documents. Students share something, able to annotate, the others contribute. Breakout groups. Let's go off and discuss something, take some notes. Professor drops in just to make sure they're doing their job. And office hours. Time to talk to the student about her performance. Let's put some of the data and one of her comments in class. What do you think? Extraordinary or just souped up WebEx? Before you answer, let me add another point that Teresa made, which is the following. This is actually not an online school, right? These individuals that you saw are logging in from the same location. They co-locate, co-live in dorms and move to seven different cities over the course of their learning experience. Isn't that crazy? I mean, the guy's doing the lessons, the lectures, right, online, but the people are living in the same place. It's a bit counterintuitive, no? It doesn't make sense. Why does it make sense? Sorry? The new world is online, but do you remember this? Who sat in a class like this? Right? What's the problem with this class? Engagement. Right? It's a great way to teach because you can teach hundreds, but it's a terrible way to learn. We know that. You can sit at the back and sleep and nobody knows. Right? You have absolutely no connection with the professor. What's more, you know, afterwards you go and see him, he doesn't even know your name. Right? So Stephen looks at, you know, the experience that they want to say, look, I want to create a school as prestigious as Harvard, as impactful as Harvard, for a quarter of the cost, right? I have something that is called a lecture. I can't do away with that. I'm a university. I have to transmit knowledge. But the lecture is broken. Can I use technology to actually make it better? Can I design something fundamentally better? And what does he do? He connects people in different ways, right? So he's able to reduce the class size to only 15 or 20 by connecting faculty from all over the world. The interactions fundamentally different by polling or debating or so on and so forth. Nobody's in the back row. You're always sort of on. And the data, right? As a result of digitalizing that experience, I'm actually able to, you know, have an office meeting with the student in a meaningful way, not just based on what I remember that she said or might have not said and at some point in time, right? He fundamentally transforms something by rethinking, you know, what is the job to be done? What are the single interactions? And how can I actually use interactions, connections, data to do that there? So that brings me to the first frame that I think we have to get rid of. And this we're late on already. And you know, Nick, my friend and colleague, has been talking about it for decades almost, right? This frame of translating analog experience to the digital world. This frame of basically taking some paper-based content and making it virtual, right? This frame of either or, right? We either do something online or we do something face-to-face. You know, this frame, by the way, is embedded deeply in our organizations, deeply. And you're kidding yourself if you don't think it is. I did some research on blended learning a couple of years ago now. It's a bit dated. But this is some of the quotes that people told, you know, had, things that they told me. E carries a bad smell. It's good for a very short period of time, very low cost, right? We like the classroom experience. Blended, less exciting. What are they saying? We see it as an alternative and a bad one. And if we're really, really, really forced, you know, beaten, we're going to try to, you know, maybe put some lipstick on the pig, right? We need to break this frame. We need to finally, you know, embrace a blended frame, because if one thing is certain, digitalization is breaking the divide between these two contexts. We're no longer online or face-to-face, right? We are continuously online and face-to-face. These two contexts are essentially blurring. And as a result of this blurring, you're able to actually look at an old experience, a lecture, and ask yourself, you know, what are the single interactions of that experience, and how can I actually make them better, applying extraordinary technology to my cutting-edge pedagogy, right? Because, you know, Stephen doesn't say, hey, we're going to be an online school. No, he says, I recognize the importance, the value of place. That's why he rotates the students around. I recognize that there's a uniqueness to community, to applying the learning in a context, to the cultural sort of interaction, right? I can't be Harvard without that, but I'm going to fix the lecture. So that's the first frame. I think that's actually not enough. I think we're late on that journey. And as I said, Nick's been talking about it for 20 years, blended learning. I mean, you know, and yet we're still resistant to actually truly design agnostically, right? But that's kind of a baby step, step one. I think we're actually on the verge of a more fundamental paradigmatic shift. And it's what you guys have been talking about, and so I'm just gonna offer another frame to think about it, right? And to do that, let's jump a minute to the world of health and fitness. Beautiful world. And no, I'm not crazy. This actually has some relevance, right? Because health and fitness is also a field that is being transformed by digitalization, right? And interestingly, it's also something that is actually, as an activity, similar in some ways to learning. You know, if you think of you know, being healthy and fit, it's sort of an endeavor that you have to pursue throughout your life, just like learning, right? You're not done being healthy and fit today. You kind of have to be healthy and fit to the grave, right? And the whole idea, in fact, is, hey, I'm trying to, you know, move that grave away, right? So it's a lot continuous, right? The other thing about healthy and fit is it actually is an aggregate of many activities, right? Many contexts in which we engage in this activity of being healthy and fit, right? I mean, as the image suggests, you drink, you sleep, you eat, all of this stuff, right? This aggregate activity actually moves you towards that goal, just like learning. It's not one thing, it's many things. And, you know, the third thing is, healthy and fit is something that is deeply dependent on your motivation, right? January 1st, you know, you set that goal. And that's you, right? Nobody's telling you to do it. Well, maybe somebody are, but you know, by and large, it's kind of you that decides to engage. And that motivation, as we know, is very difficult to sustain, right? January 31st, that person's an idiot. You know, who was that fool that, you know? And it's so difficult to sustain because it's kind of this private, you know, journey. You don't know if you're going forwards or backwards sometimes. And, you know, just like learning, right? We have to motivate ourselves to sometimes learn, and in a way, sometimes we don't know if we're actually making progress or not. And so, you know, the questions around being healthy and fit are kind of similar, right? How do we actually sustain motivation? How do we, you know, sum up this these many different activities into sort of an aggregate? How do we know if we're actually learning at all or being healthy and fit at all? And along comes something like this, right? I'm not advocating we all go out and buy a Fitbit, but I want to think with you just a minute about the effect of this device on the practice, the social practice of pursuing a healthy and fit life, right? Who has a Fitbit? Who has something like this? Effect? Any? Some?
Makes you more aware.
Right?
But I think the motivation starts high and then...
Sure, because we're humans, right? I mean, for those that sort of buy in, and of course this is not a sort of silver bullet, what is this thing? It actually lowers the barriers for you to engage, right? It provides a motivational boost, not only because it's sexy and nice, but because it actually attacks the very things that hinder our ability to engage in a healthy and a fit lifestyle. What are those things? Well, first of all, you know, the aggregation of many different activities, right? All of a sudden, you know, your eating is combined with your walking, combined with your sleeping, combined with your, and yes, it's imperfect still today. Some of it is manual, but, you know, this is going to be solved. Tomorrow it's, you know, so it integrates into a sort of holistic journey, many separate activities. The other thing it does is, you know, it provides you these little sort of charts of your progress, right? These infographic charts. It tells you, hey, what have you been doing? And it's not only about that, the past. It's also about what should you be doing next, right? These contextualized reminders that tell you, hey, you know, it's 25 minutes you've been sitting. Maybe you should get up and, you know, take a walk, or even more sort of offensive ones. And you know, the third thing has to do with this social dimension, right? All of a sudden, you're able to share what you're doing, share. You know, what others are doing, get suggestions, and so on and so forth, right? So essentially, it transforms this kind of disaggregated set of activities, this private journey, this difficult to sustain sort of endeavor into kind of an integrated, experience that is actually shared with others. And by doing so, dramatically lowers the barriers for our engagement. This is the kind of sort of paradigm shift that I think, you know, will eventually come to learning. So, you know, the question we need to ask ourselves, like the guys are in health and fitness are asking ourselves, is not so much, you know, what technology? Is it a MOOC versus something else? But rather, in a world in which, you know, we achieve 100% digital density, how will executives learn, right? How will executives learn, right? If we live in a world in which every connection that is possible to people or things exists, and therefore a world in which interactions can travel on those connections and from which we can extract data, how will executives actually learn? Which doesn't mean, you know, we're going to have a sort of Fitbit for learning, but who knows, maybe we might. So I think three characteristics, and this is the frame that I, you know, or the characteristics of the learning of the, you know, this paradigm shift that I think is happening. The first one has to do with kind of this cross-context nature of learning, right? Learning up until now was sort of, you know, within a particular context and an aggregate of, right? I think learning is shifting to a sort of continuous and cross-context nature, and we've been talking about it in many presentations, right? The fact that learning is embedded into everyday life, and there's many situations, whether it's a physical situation or a particular work or other situations, you know, spatial or contextual, that actually are full of learning moments. What's a learning moment? Something that prompts reflection, right? And so the key is actually grabbing these and integrating them into your journey, right? So if that's the case, I think the second characteristic has to do with this idea of learner-led and to some extent social, right? My learning journey is going to be different from your learning journey if it's embedded into my everyday life. It might have some of the same elements, but it's not going to be identical. And so the responsibility in terms of grabbing those moments, reflecting on them, extracting patterns, resides with me and with no one else. And as I engage in the activity, I'm also actually empowered to share it with others. Others that might either be interested in how I'm progressing or others from who I can gain insight into what I might do next. This idea of personalization. And the third characteristic has to do with data, of course, right? Data. But data, we often think of data as sort of an output. We say, okay, what have I been doing the last 6 months? Or what have I been doing, right? This is a limiting view of data, right? We know it, we've been talking about it. Data as an input is much more useful. The contextualized reminders are the very reason why I'm willing to give Fitbit my data. If they didn't give me that, I don't need another marketing spam in my inbox, right? Likewise, data as input, what are you going to do next? This idea of personalization becomes possible when you have a learning journey in which essentially you're grabbing, storing, and then reflecting on all of these learning moments. So this sort of concept, we've sort of labeled it as Omni-Learning at IESE, and we think these are some of the characteristics of the way in which executives will learn in a 100% digital dense world. What does this require? And this is the second frame that I want to suggest we break. It requires, you know, focusing on the quarter-inch hole. You'll probably, recognize this saying from Theodore Levitt, marketing professor at Harvard, right? We don't need a quarter-inch drill. What customers want is a quarter-inch hole. And yet in our profession, in learning development, we keep thinking about the drills, right? What are the drills? These up here, learner-led stuff, coaching and mentoring, e-learning courses, instructor class. Okay, these are important. I'm not suggesting that we do away with these. But in fact, what we need to be thinking about is sort of the whole. What is the individual actually pursuing? And how can I integrate, you know, I borrow this chart from my friends at Degreed, how can I actually integrate all of the activities that are moving that individual towards drilling that hole, right? And so my role is not so, as an L&D professional, is not so much one of a creator. And it's not so sort of in your face. It's actually one of a facilitator. It's a stealth learning and development where I provide an infrastructure to do what? For individuals to grab learning, to embed reflection, to generalize patterns, et cetera, et cetera. And the last sort of tidbit that I want to leave with you has to do with how. How do we actually do this? A frame that is actually you know, very, very fresh paint. The fruit of some of the work that we're doing with the EFMD, there's a digital age learning group that I'm involved in, and we've been reflecting on some of these things, and I wanted to share it with you. We'll see how it goes. But, you know, how do we actually make Omni-Learning, this kind of experience, a reality, you know? What actually do you have to do to design, Omni-Journeys, if you will? It's not too different than what we've been doing up until now in terms of the steps. Of course, like always, the devil is in the detail, right? So the first step, like we know, is that of exploring needs. But in an omni world, the needs are individualistic, tied to the person, their role today, and their role tomorrow. You're able to achieve a sort of personalization at the individual level that is perhaps far greater than we've ever thought of before. And so the exploration of the needs in terms of skills, capabilities, and so on, of what the person needs today and what they need tomorrow is fundamental to Omni-Learning. Of course, once that's done, the next step is the identifying opportunities. What are opportunities? Again, these learning moments, right? Things that prompt reflection. And these moments are embedded in, as I said, in everyday life, right? It's the talk I give today. It's the article I'll read in the taxi ride home. It's a conversation that I'll have with my boss. And yes, it is also the program that I will go to at IESE or Instituto Empresa or wherever, right? But these learning moments, these opportunities for reflection are fundamental. And we need to help people to identify them, right? To actually think about them, because they are the ones that actually proactively have to then grab them. And you know, you don't have to be exhaustive, but a first set is probably important. Next step is the enablement, right? And here, you know, part of it has to do with the infrastructure. The technology infrastructure. We know that's important. What does this technology infrastructure allow us to do? Well, to capture these learning moments, to organize them, to embed reflection, to socialize, et cetera, right? To personalize and so on. This is important. We need this infrastructure. But we also need a different mindset, the sort of facilitation mindset that comes with it. And finally, enhancing the future. And this is the promise of, you know, personalization fundamentally, right? As we digitalize, not the actions, not the components of learning, but the ability to sort of capture, organize, extract patterns from them, we can then start to think of, you know, being proactive in terms of advising next steps. And, you know, our assessments today are kind of these annual, you know, via crucis type things. We can move towards an assessment that is almost daily, right, or real time if we want, involving whoever needs to be involved, some peers, bosses, why not family, I mean, right? So if this is kind of where we're going, of course, as I said, we need a technological infrastructure, but people get focused on this and make it sort of an obsession, a little bit like the MOOC story, right? They're like, okay, you know, we need different tools, and there's many that are emerging. These are just some of the ones that we're working with at IESE. There's many exciting ones that are emerging that are enabling to, you know, do things in entirely new ways, right? The problem right now is the lack of this nice little, right, frame around it, because nobody wants to live a life with 55 apps, right? So, but this problem, this technological infrastructure is actually gonna be solved by somebody outside this room, and we're just gonna benefit from that, right? What's not going to be solved by somebody from outside this room is the frame. The frame in terms of the people that we need to actually enable these omni-type experiences. So this is our old frame. This is the frame that we've been living with, that we're comfortable with, you know, for decades, right? We've got learning over here, pretty much formal, and there's some other stuff going on, but we control the formal stuff as L&D because we are the function of L&D. And to do that, we got people, call them instructional designers or whatever, our team, right? And so it's a sort of, you know, L&D that is kind of very present, very visible, a creator of experiences, and that's our job, right? I think we need to break that frame as well. Learning, as we said, omni, right? Continuous, learner-led, data-driven. And L&D, a dimension, right? We talk about culture, the culture of learning. A dimension is not sort of in your face, it's stealth. A dimension is not kind of programmatic, it's infrastructure focused, right? We need to think of L&D as an enabler of this omni-learning as opposed to a creator of. And therefore, I think we need different mindsets in terms of the people in our teams as well as the function as a whole. And this is the work that we've been trying to do or make sense of with EFMD. And I'm going to share briefly with you to see how it sits. And as I said, fresh paint, so it's still a process of in refinement. You know, think about it for a minute, right? In the exploration of the need, right? We know that we sort of agree that that's a necessary step. What kind of mindsets do you need at that point? These are the ones that we were able to surface, right? We need, at the L&D level, we need much more expertise in data science, right? This idea of data not as an output, as something that, you know, produces a chart. How many people showed up to the training? You know, was it, you know, but actually data as input. What are you going to do next, right? At the even individual level, this is the way, the mindset of a data scientist. And we need to acquire that. We need that expertise in L&D. In our instructional designers, who are going to become sort of learning experience designers, right, we need them to act as design thinkers. What does a design thinker do differently? Design thinker doesn't sort of sit on some information, right? He actually, he or she, you know, ethnographically, anthropologically, you know, looks at the environment in which the learners are working and playing and sees what it is that they actually do, right? That's the type of sort of exploration that we need. Not a report-based exploration, but actually a much more ethnographic one. Kind of there. Next step is, you know, this identification of opportunities, right? These learning moments, these moments for reflection, or that prompt reflection. You know, the idea that we're embedded in everyday life, in every sort of context of everyday life, right? At the L&D level, we need sort of a co-creation capability. You know, we talk about this. We say, oh yeah, we're going to co-create with the business. What does that actually mean? We go interview a few people, return to our cubicle, design a product, and ship it out. Co-creators are actually, you know, people that are deeply embedded in the business. Because if learning is happening in everyday life, it's happening in the moments in which managers are actually engaging, either with colleagues or with clients, or in fact, on their own. So this co-creation has to be sort of ratcheted up a notch, right? To a different level, one of kind of symbiotic almost implication with the business. And you know, in our learning experience designers, we need to think like UX designers. Mobile is not a nice thing to have. It's actually fundamental to the experience working, right? That's how a UX designer, it's not the content first and then we'll figure out how to ship it out. We actually have to think about the experience as a UX designer does, and then we'll figure out the content issue. Finally, enablement, right? Enablement of the journey. You know, how do we actually create an infrastructure, which is part technology, part facilitators, that enables learning to happen in a continuous learner-led, data-driven way. At the L&D level, we need makers and tinkers. We need people that are at the cutting edge, right? We need people that are buying Alexa, putting it in their house, and figuring out what the hell they're going to do with this thing, right? You know, maker and tinkers are essentially, you know, experimenters with what's out there. I don't know what's going to come from it. I'm just going to play for a while, right? This capability is somewhat absent, you know, in the L&D function. For our experienced designers, prototypers, a prototype mindset. What's our mindset today? Piloting. What does piloting mean? It's pretty damn near perfect. Right? Does anybody, I mean, who really does a pilot that says, hey, it's going to be like really, really, you know, shaky? You do a pilot after 5 months of, or 10 months, whatever, planning, and if you change two things, it's been a good pilot. The prototype mindset is an agile mindset. It's a mindset of let's put something out there and let's work it out together. And the first time, it's going to be a bumpy ride, right? Of course, you know, at some point, that prototype becomes something you want to scale. And at the L&D level, I think we still need and probably need to be better in terms of optimizing. How do you scale experiments, right? That requires a little bit of assessment up front of, you know, if this thing really works, what does it imply down the road, right? Because I don't know. And so this optimization. But never lose in your experienced designers the disruptive mindset, right? This ability to actually ask the question, is this really working at all? I mean, things are moving so fast and new opportunities are becoming available that what you did last year is, you know, possibly irrelevant or outdated or not the best. And we need to be able much more to actually just throw it out and jump on the next thing, which is tough. Right? We designed something for, you know, the next 5 years. We're going to... So I think these are kind of the mindset. You know, to finish, I think it's an extremely exciting time. No, because perhaps for the first time in history, we're actually able to put in practice, you know, some of the theories of our idols of the past. You know, the Montessoris or the Seeleys, or I don't know who your theorists are of reference. But you know, these people that dreamt about personalized learning. You know, people that dreamt about work sort of. Work learning embedded in work. People that dreamt about, you know, continuous sort of application and so on and so forth. Yet, you know, the theories were right, but sort of their tool set was wrong. And I think we now have a tool set that is actually allowing us to combine this extraordinary pedagogy with cutting edge technology and create fundamentally different learning experiences for our learners. That's all I got. Thank you very much. Thank you.